things which we need to be familiar with is a set of CBP forms. One form is CBP form 7551, which is a drawback entry. 7552, which is a certificate of manufacturing delivery, reproduced over here. And another form, which is relevant for our drawback discussion, is notice of intent to export or destroy the merchandise. 7553. This form is becoming less relevant after the Trade Enforcement and Trade Facilitation Act, because we're this form traces the certificate of manufacture and delivery, traces the chain of custody of the product, the transfer. Every time there is a transfer, and transfer is a buzzword here, as we will see, you have to document this. Now, Trade Enforcement, Trade Facilitation Act said, you probably will still be able to use this form, and it is not likely that it will go away, but you will have an option. Whereas before you had to use that form, now you can use whatever methodology you keep in the regular course of business. If it establishes the chain of custody, you will be fine. 7553 has to do with notice of intent to export or destroy. It's applicable. The destruction is applicable to all types of drawback. The notice of export is applicable to unused merchandise and rejected, but not manufacturing. And the key thing to remember here is the number of days and to what type of drawback it is applicable. So keep those points in mind as we go through the outline and we discuss those forms. Going back to the table itself, we know that so we have this breakdown. And to file a drawback, of course, this is a must. This is like 7501 for the entry. CBP form 7551 is for the drawback. It takes all relevant information and it starts the process going. This form, chain of custody, as I mentioned, if currently under old rules, if there is a transfer, every time there is a transfer, it is required, because if there is no transfer, the chain of custody is clear. It's within one person's domain. And that person can be the importer of merchandise and the exporter or destroyer at the same time. But if it's more than one person, then you have to document the transfer. 7553, I think please be mindful of this particular line, because it can be useful as you sit on the exam as a good reference tool of all the days that would be applicable for submitting of the form. Of course, there are exceptions. You can apply for an exception of it's called the waiver of the notice of intent to export. Waiver can also be will also be subdivided into the forward-looking waiver, which means that you have to apply and get waiver approval before actual export takes place. And there is also a backward-looking waiver where you can do that after the fact. Nowadays, the after-the-fact waiver is limited only to one time single use, and it is also discretionary for customs to approve or deny this. So, destruction is applicable to all types of merchandise, all types of drawback, and it is 7 working days rule. Keep in mind, when you speak working day equals business day. And the reason for working day equal is business day, the reason for you to pay attention to that is because throughout the past, customs examiners have been alternating these words during the customs broker exam questions. So notice of if this is the first two is applicable to the manufacturing drawback, right? So they're applicable to the manufacturing drawback variations. The export one, right? There is no such requirement of the manufacturing drawback, no such requirement of export notice. Unused merchandise and rejected merchandise is another story. So in this case, both direct identification and substitution variation for unused merchandise, they have two working day requirement for filing, at least two working days, and the export has five working days requirement. Also, I'd like to bring your attention to the waiver discussion in the informed compliance publication. Let me see, I think I have it up. Yeah, right there. So notice of exportation destruction, customs goes into this two working day rule, five working day rule, and also the waivers. So basically that chart represents the snippet of whatever is here. So that's CBP form 7553. So import entry numbers, of course, you have to relate this to the original entry, because there is no drawback. Even substitution has to be tied to the importation, because you are asking for amount of duties paid, 99 duties and fees paid, and without import there would be no duties, correct? So coding sheet required unless it's filed electronically. So more and more of this stuff goes in the online world. Coding sheet is simple. Is a simple form. Let me see. I think I have it up over here. It says a sample coding sheet over here. So here is the example which customs GFK office encourages its filers to use. So you have a line item breakdown for the duties, MPF, HMF, and taxes. Taxes, of course, excise taxes are collected by customs on such thing as the spirits, beer, alcohol, and wine, hard liquor, and wine. So it pretty much provides you the line item breakdown and the totals. All right. So coding sheet is just a tool which allows customs to easily review the calculations that are reported on the CBP form 7551, the entry, the drawback entry. And other documents, they are possible because sometimes customs is would like to ask for supporting documentation if they are not satisfied with the basic bare bone application. So they can ask for the entry documents, the commercial invoices. They can ask for, sometimes they can go even further, they request records that would relate to those, to the fact of the importation, by asking for such thing as the timesheet records of the employees who participated in the production of the the merchandise which was originally imported. So it's if customs feels like there is more questions to ask because the entry for one reason or another looks suspicious, they reserve the right to do that under section 191.52. All right, so here is one of the quiz breaks, one of the questions from the past, which is pretty straightforward question. Which CBP form is required to request a drawback claim? And of course, the drawback claim is done under the CBP form 7551. Those CBP form questions are pretty easy to answer if you have if you come in and you sit down prepared. For one thing, what on my end, what I've done to help folks who are preparing for the exam is there is a whole different chapter, chapter 32, called Commonly Tested Form chapter. It's in, and depending on the edition, chapter number may vary, right? Because as customer examiners become more creative, it creates the need to break down to increase number of topics, and consequently number of chapters keeps on growing as part of the preparation. But commonly tested forms is a compilation of various forms which customs examiners are covering, have covered on their exam. So starting from the low and going to higher and higher, and of course also covering some of the forms which are not CBP forms, such as EPA forms, DOT forms, I don't know if they had FWS forms, but pretty much the summary compilation of the forms, right, which come up on a customs broker exam, right? So let's see if we have 5601 is there, right? And we saw that as one of the answer choices. Other forms came up, and of course, the chapter attempts to correlate them to the form and to how those questions are being asked. So this is pretty much the good tool. So this is 7553, right? One of the forms which is used for drawback claims, rejected merchandise drawback claim, right? So this is one example of how customs examiners use this form. So be mindful of this resource, that it is available. It is designed to not only to be to expand your knowledge, but also to save your time on the customs broker exam, because the forms are coming in increasing order. And if by any chance you are not familiar with the form or how it is being tested, the commonly tested forms chapter is a great resource and a great time saver during the time of the exam. All right, now that's for commonly tested forms. Of course, as you prepare, you will not have that luxury during the time of the exam, because you'll be restricted even if you take the electronic version. But if you go to the website cbp.gov, right, the official customs website, and you scroll down to the bottom, you'll see that forms, right? Click on that forms and any forms. So, for example, you should know that taking the exam not only involves pinpointing the right answer off the bat, which you can, but also involves like asking questions. For example, if you eliminating the wrong answers, asking questions of which answers should be eliminated too. That way you are reassured that you are getting this one correctly, and it also gives you a chance to practice your knowledge on other forms as well. So so commonly tested forms chapter is one tool. Another tool is that website. So if you are looking at form 5106, okay, what is that form? Should I eliminate it, and for what reason? You enter the form 5106 here into the search box, and you get that importer ID input of record, and you have that sample, right? And it gives you an idea of what this form is used for. So in case of 5106, you know that it is used so customs, if you are the first time importer, let's say, to get you in the system, you have to file this form, so customs recognizes, okay, I know who this person is because they have your number. And when you, on CBP form 7501, when you place the importer of record number, so let's see. So let's go to 7501 entry summary. So let's say over here you are you place importer number, right? That number is correlated to the CBP form 50106 number, which already gives customs the signal. Okay, we know who we have the information about this particular importer, or for that matter, cosignee, because cosignee also has to the ultimate cosignee to be identified in the system. That form also needs to be used for that cosignee entity as well. All right, so so this is those are the two resources which you should be actively using, because the inquiry here takes you all over the chart. So CBP form 301 you should recognize, and you pretty much yes, you should have this the list, like commonly tested forms list, right, in the chapter that I suggested. But you also should be become familiar with the recognition of more familiar and more frequently tested forms. 5106 is one of those forms. 7551, the drawback entry, is one of those forms. 301, which deals with bonds, also very, very frequently tested. This form you should know, because this is an application for the customs broker license exam. So to see the exam, you need to fill out this form in an electronic version of it. Because without this, you're not taking the exam. So this is one of the forms you should know. And CBP form 19 if you haven't covered protests yet, then you're probably not familiar with it. This is a form that you use to file a protest under the 19 U.S.C. 1514 procedure. In other words, you are disagreeing. Let's say customs assess more duties, and you think that customs is wrong, so you file a protest. So you start this administrative inquiry into whether customs did the right thing or wrong thing. And you can escalate it even to headquarters by filing the further review. So this way you avoid the intellectual bias associated with a particular administrative decision of customs. So learn to recognize this form. So here, CBP form 7551 is correct.